Thank you so much for that very kind introduction, and it's great for me to be here. I'm very pleased to give you an overview of the kind of work that we've been doing in exposure therapy. I must say that I have three main lines of research that I follow. I do a lot of work on what are the risk factors for anxiety and depression in longitudinal research. Another arm of my research is implementation of evidence-based treatments into real-world settings, such as primary care. But the third arm of my research, which is where I began my research under the mentorship of Jack Rackman, is about the mechanisms of treatment and specifically the mechanisms of exposure therapy. And so that's what I'm going to be talking about today, as was indicated in the introduction. So to set the scene, what do we mean by exposure therapy? Clearly, we mean repeated, systematic exposure to either internal or external cues that are feared, avoided, or endured with dread. And we generally categorize exposure into one of three types. We have in vivo exposure, which is the exposure to the naturalistic setting, such as the lovely freeway around Los Angeles, of the traffic that's packed to the hilt. We have imaginal exposure, exposure to one's memories, traumatic memories, exposure to catastrophic images, or exposure to obsessive material. And then we have what's called interoceptive exposure, which is the exposure to feared internal bodily sensations represented here by this image of the person spinning around. We know from quite a few different meta-analyses that exposure-based treatments, whether conducted alone or in combination with various other kind of strategies like cognitive strategies or somatic strategies, which in the long run don't seem to boost effect size very much, but that exposure-based treatments are highly effective. And with effect sizes that are large for almost all, if not all, of the anxiety disorders. But it's not foolproof. And it's not foolproof for a number of reasons. So we know, first of all, that a number of people refuse to undertake exposure therapy. That's hard to estimate the numbers here. This was from a clinic in Australia where after describing what would be involved in the treatment that involved exposure therapy, they estimated that 30% dropped out, which is actually quite large. We also have what's called treatment attrition, so people who drop out, and this is dropping out of exposure-based therapies broadly defined, often with and without those other cognitive or somatic coping techniques, and typically it's about 15 to 30%, and often the dropout is not too long after exposure is introduced. But I think more importantly, and where I'm going to focus today, is this. It's actually the case that when you look at all of the studies, because we've just done this review, all of the studies published to date on exposure-based treatments for all the anxiety disorders, and you ask how many of the sample actually achieved clinically significant change, you actually get a non-response rate of 40 to 50%, which is kind of startling when you think about it. So 40 to 50% do not achieve a clinically significant and reliable change. And then on top of that, there's this phenomenon called return of fear, which is where I started my career. Return of fear literally means that the individual experiences a resurgence of fear after exposure therapy is over to the target of exposure therapy. So it's not relapse per se, it's fear of a specific object or situation that was targeted in exposure therapy. So this begs the question, what are the mechanisms of exposure therapy and how can those mechanisms be optimized in such a way that we can enhance the response rate and reduce the return of fear? So over the years, I've done a lot of research on this question, often relying on specific phobic type of stimuli because they're easy to manipulate, they're easy to control, and then more recently applying it in more severe, clinically pervasive anxiety disorders. But we have done a lot of work with spider phobias. This is Pepe. He's our Chilean tarantula. Chilean rose tarantula, non-poisonous. We have about 7 of him in the lab. So we've done a lot of work with spider phobias. We've done a lot of work with claustrophobia. This is our panic booth. I don't know why, I didn't put that there, but. once you close the door, you can't get out because there's no handle on the inside. So it's a claustrophobic booth. We've done a lot of work with public speaking fears. And we've done a lot of work with exposure to heights. Although this one, the IRB at our university was a little concerned about, so we haven't proceeded quite with that height. So, as you may recall, and certainly I was trained in this way, that originally the thought was, when you do exposure therapy, you have to keep the patient in the situation until the fear declines. That was like a rule. And that if you didn't do that, you were potentially causing problems, worsening the person's anxiety. And so this was based on an habituation model of exposure therapy, which was quite powerful in the 1960s and 1970s. The first question we asked is, does the reduction of fear from the beginning to the end of an exposure trial have anything to do with how the person's responding when they come back at a later point in time? And so typically, fear does habituate. More often than not, you do see that reduction from the beginning to the end of an exposure trial. This is one of the buildings opposite my building in UCLA, and we often take people up there to do height exposure. And if you take a group of people with acrophobia through this kind of height exposure and monitor their minute-by-minute fear level, you see this nice habituation curve that typically does happen. But when you evaluate whether the degree to which fear reduces from the beginning to the end of the exposure trial or from the peak to the end of exposure trial, and then see if that relates in any way to the performance at 3-week follow-up when they come back for a behavioral avoidance test co-varying where they started at, this is just a quick diagram to show there is no relationship. There's no relationship between how much fear reduced from the peak to the end of an exposure trial and how well they're doing. There's no linear connection here. And we've replicated that in 3 different studies, and other people have replicated that finding too. We even did a study where this was a study with spider phobias. We took the individuals through exposure trials. Each trial was 3 minutes in duration with a 1-minute intertrial interval, so they had a break for 1 minute, and we brought everybody down to their fear being less than 10 on a 0 to 100-point scale. So they had habituated. They were at a very low level. And at that point, we randomized participants to either a control condition where they did no more or an overlearning condition. The overlearning condition means that they stay doing repeated exposure trials 200% more than what it took them to get to that first level of below 10, so that they're repeatedly in the presence of the phobic stimulus with a very low level of fear. And you would think from an habituation model that would be very powerful. The person's not only down at a 10 or less, but repeatedly over and over and over again. And then we followed them up 3 weeks later. And this is the overlearning group. And that's a return of fear. So even being at the low level for longer number of trials or more trials did not provide a benefit, and if anything, it provided a return of fear. So what's going on? If habituation, if that reduction in the fear response itself is not the critical index of learning as determined by how the individual's functioning when you bring them back and test them at a later point in time, what is it that's going on? So this brings us back to our basic science of fear learning, which is where exposure therapy began. So when Joseph Wolpe introduced systematic desensitization as the first form of exposure therapy, he was taking from extinction learning theory. And in some ways, we've kind of lost that basis to what we do. And my goal has been to study the extinction learning model and see how can we use what's been gained in knowledge in that area to help us. So back to undergraduate psychology for a second. You know that the Pavlovian fear conditioning starts off with a fear acquisition phase where a neutral stimulus is paired with a shock. Then there's a fear extinction phase where the tone, the neutral stimulus, the CS, is now presented alone without the shock. And then there's a test phase where you're testing what is the long-term effect of this extinction training. And just like with our human studies, the animal studies show that how much fear reduces within this block of time, and typically in rats that means how much do they freeze less, or how much they're freezing at the end of that is not a predictor of how they respond at retest. And in our own lab studies, when we use humans and tone shock pairings, we get the same effect. So that maps on to what we observed in our analog samples of spider phobics and public speaking phobics and so forth. So what is it? What's going on in extinction if it's not all about that reduction of fear in the moment? So some of you may know this, but of late there's been a shift in the way extinction is thought about as a mechanism, so that nowadays we recognize that initially, there's a fear cycle, right? And so what that means is that some kind of conditional stimulus, some kind of phobic element, is a predictor of a negative event. As animals or humans go through extinction, what's happening is another memory is being formed. This new memory means that that phobic stimulus is not a predictor of the aversive event. And these two associations, these two meanings that are attached to the conditional stimulus are now stored in memory. And another part of this model is that this never goes away. When I was going through graduate training, we thought we were obliterating that. We thought we were erasing fear. But in reality, this does not go away. It's just stored in memory and less available to consciousness when this memory becomes more powerful. There are some very specific conditions, if you can target this learning right after it's happened, where you might be able to erase it, but not in a clinical situation where people are coming in for treatment often years after they acquired their fear. So let's translate that to a clinical situation. The individual comes into treatment with some kind of threat expectancy, some kind of notion that that stimulus that I'm afraid of is going to be predictive of a negative outcome. If I panic, I might die. If I go into a social situation, I might be rejected. If I approach a dog, I might be attacked. So there's a threat expectancy. As we take people through exposure therapy, we're developing a competing non-threat expectancy that if I panic, I'm not going to die. If I approach the dog, I'm not going to be attacked. Now, how is the person going to be reacting when they come back after exposure therapy is over? They will react with either fear or not, depending on which of these two memories is activated. So if you activate this memory, they'll be fearful. If you activate this memory, they'll be less fearful. So the question is, how is that determined? Which of those two memories are activated? And what we know is that the activation is dependent on things like this. This learning is very context specific. So let's call this extinction learning or exposure therapy. What the person learns throughout this part of treatment gets tied to the context of the treatment. This initial learning is not context specific at all. It generalizes rapidly. So if the person encounters their previously feared stimulus in a context over here that's very different than the context in which exposure therapy took place, this is the memory that's likely to be activated. Similarly, if a lot of time passes from the end of exposure therapy to when they re-encounter the phobic stimulus, so they finished exposure therapy, they've done tremendously well with public speaking situations, but they don't go into another public speaking situation for 9 months later, time alone, the passage of time alone will reactivate the original memory, because the original memory has greater storage strength than the new memory. And with greater storage strength, primary memories are more likely to reappear. We have also, if the individual goes through exposure therapy and then they have an unexpected negative event happen in their lives, that has the capacity to reinstate the original threat expectancy. So if somebody goes through exposure therapy for social anxiety and they do well, and then they suddenly get massively criticized when they raise their hand to ask a question in an audience, that unexpected criticism can reactivate the original excitatory memory. And then there's something called rapid reacquisition or repairing. So if a person's been traumatized, they go through therapy, they've developed a non-threat expectancy, and they're re-traumatized, naturally this is going to activate again. So notice, none of these have anything to do with how much fear was expressed during exposure therapy. That level of fear doesn't seem to moderate which of these two memories is activated at a later point in time. So what we need to do in exposure therapy is we need to develop this to be so powerful, this non-threat expectancy, that it will be so powerful and so retrievable at a later point in time that it's going to offset all of these factors and compete with that threat expectancy. That's the basic model. Now, this notion of extinction as being really the inhibition of one threat expectancy association with another new association that's not involving threat, that inhibitory model is well supported now in the literature. It's well supported in the neurobiology. There's been a lot of work done looking at the underlying neurobiology of fear acquisition and fear extinction. And it's pretty clear that as people go through initial fear acquisition, what's involved mainly is the amygdala. And as they go through fear extinction, particularly when you're measuring their recall of the extinction at a later point in time, it's pretty much the ventral medial prefrontal cortex, and that prefrontal cortex is serving to inhibit the amygdala. So it's an inhibitory regulatory pathway. And certainly in our own hands, nowadays we are doing more and more and more of neuroimaging. And in this small pilot study, we took healthy controls through basic fear acquisition and extinction. We saw that ventral medial prefrontal cortex activation during extinction, and it massively correlated negatively with amygdala. So the more active that ventral medial prefrontal cortex, the less active the amygdala. And that's just, you know, replicating what others have found. So how can we make that inhibitory learning maximally powerful, and how can we make it maximally retrievable at a later point in time so that it is competing successfully with the original excitatory association? Okay, so that's how we think extinction / exposure should be working, but we have a major glitch to deal with. And the glitch is that individuals with anxiety disorders have deficits in the very mechanism that we are trying to work on in exposure and extinction. They have deficits in inhibitory regulation and inhibitory learning. And I would argue those deficits are probably one of the main reasons why they're anxious in the first place. So what do I mean by this, a deficit? I'll give you two examples. This was a study we did with kids. They were around 8 to 12 years of age. And we took them through a very simple conditioning paradigm where one geometric figure was paired with a loud tone. We didn't use shock in this study because they were kids. And then we had another geometric figure that was never paired with a loud tone. So this is called differential conditioning. And they first of all went through acquisition, so 8 trials of this, 8 trials of that. We then took them through extinction. So simply that means there's no more loud tone. So it's just the geometric figures. Then 1 to 2 weeks later, we brought them back and we tested their performance. That's called extinction test, sometimes also called spontaneous recovery. And here we go. Here are the anxious kids and the control kids. So you can see that, first of all, the anxious kids acquired a stronger fear response. This is skin conductance, which is a good measure of fear arousal. A stronger fear response than the control kids. And this is during extinction. You see how the control kids, this is the geometric figure that was paired with shock. They reduced their fear, so they extinguished. But look at the anxious kids. They didn't extinguish. And look at this 1 to 2 weeks later, the control kids still extinguishing, the anxious kids, if anything, going up. So that failure to extinguish is looked at as a failure of inhibitory regulation. So they're not engaging in what should be happening during extinction, which is inhibitory regulation. Here's another example. A slightly different paradigm. This is what we call the fear potentiated startle paradigm. It's within a larger study, but I want you to focus just on these two phases, the safe danger phases. So this is now with 16-year-olds. They come into the lab. We hook them up with some sort of sensors that are put onto their biceps. And through these electrodes, they're going to get shocked. Although we use the term contraction, just for the sake of, I don't know why, but we did. In the safe phases, they got this screen that said safe. No contraction will be given. And then in the danger phase, it said danger. Contraction may be given. And they had been told that if you're going to get shocked, it's going to happen, in the last 10 seconds of a countdown from 0 to 55. So it counted down. I couldn't do this technically, I'm not very good, but it would count down, and this orange thing would get darker and darker and darker as it went. And they were told, you may receive up to 3 shocks throughout the experiment, and each one may be worse than the last. So we were definitely trying to induce a state of anxiety, shall we say. And then what actually happened is that everybody got 4 safe phases and 4 danger phases, and then everybody got 1 shock, just 1 shock, and then they repeated another 4 safe phases and 4 danger phases. In this first study, we wanted to see how do those individuals who are at risk for anxiety react. So that means, how do individuals who are high in neuroticism, so neuroticism is that personality trait, and in all of our longitudinal research about what predicts the onset of anxiety disorders, neuroticism comes up all the time. So it's a trait, a personality trait, that seems to have a really powerful effect on the development of anxiety and depression, for that matter. Okay, so this bit here is before that 1 shock is given. This bit here is after that 1 shock is given. The threat phase is that danger thing. This is the proximal, meaning the last 10 seconds. Actually here, everybody is reacting strongly. This is the blink of the eye, the startle blink, which is a nice measure of defensive reactivity. So appropriately, everybody's really defensive when they think, oh my God, I'm going to get shocked in this last 10 seconds here. And there was no difference between the 3 groups. Look at the safe phase though. When the green screen was on, you're safe, nothing's going to happen. That's when you see the high neurotics overreacting comparing to the other groups. These are significant differences. They look small, but they're actually big in the world of startle reflex. It's as if, you know, I sort of think of this as, it's as if, you know, a child is on the playground and they get bullied by another child. The person who's at risk for anxiety not only reacts strongly to the bully, they're now reacting strongly to everybody else on the playground. These are the safe people that they're not able to inhibit their fear response to. So they're showing a deficit in the regulation of their fear to what should be a safe signal. And I think that contributes to fear generalization. Interestingly, by the way, we then took those startle data, how people reacted to those safe phases, and evaluated, is this a predictor of who develops anxiety in the long term? And it was a very big predictor. So this particular index, that overreaction to what should be a safe cue, is actually a significant predictor of who develops anxiety disorders 3 to 4 years later. And it's not a predictor of depression. It seems to be unique to anxiety and doesn't predict depression. This is one of the few cases where we've actually found a differential between anxiety and depression. Okay, so to put it together, we want exposure therapy to work on developing inhibitory learning and inhibitory regulation because we think that's a critical mechanism, but we're dealing with individuals who seem to have deficits in those pathways, and that just makes our job harder. So to that end, what I've been doing for the last few years is trying to evaluate what are the ways that we can enhance that inhibitory learning and regulation through exposure therapy. These are the different avenues that we have been following. I'm not going to go through all of them, but I'm going to take you through some of them. And it's a lot of data, but hopefully by the end you'll come away with a set of tools where you say, okay, let's try this out. Let's try this version out, because there are lots of different ways that you can do this. So we're going to start with violation of expectancies. So what do I mean by that? What I mean, when you look at the basic elements of learning, learning is enhanced by the mismatch between what is expected to occur and what actually occurs. And so the more mismatch there is, the greater the learning that should take place. And this was the Ruskola-Wagner model of extinction learning, that extinction is the animal coming into the situation expecting to get shocked and not getting shocked. And that mismatch is critical to learning. So that for us means, okay, we need to design our conditions of exposure that maximally violate expectancies. So here's a study where we took people who had acrophobia and we divided them into what we called a disconfirmation group or a non-disconfirmation group. The disconfirmation group, we said, okay, here you are. What is it you're most worried about happening when you're up at this very high rail looking over the edge? I'm afraid I'm going to faint. Okay. How long would you have to be up there before you're pretty certain that you'll actually faint? 12 minutes. Okay, we're going to do the trial for 15 minutes. So you see what we've done? We've expanded it beyond the point at which they're certain the negative outcome is going to occur. And they had one trial. They just did it one time. Two separate days, so they did one on each day. We compared that to a no disconfirmation group, where they did repeated trials each day for the duration at which they felt like, I don't know, maybe I would, maybe I wouldn't fall. So you see what we're trying to do here? We're trying to test a maximal violation of expectancy against an uncertain violation of expectancy. And what actually happened is that, yes, they had two trials. They had, on average, 7 trials. We tried to match on duration through yoking. We couldn't do it. So this disconfirmation group had a shorter duration overall compared to the non-disconfirmation group. And then we tested them at follow-up, and there was no difference. The critical thing here is that the disconfirmation group had one trial on each day, and they still got the same effects as the group that had the multiple trials for longer. So that was one demonstration of the role of violation of expectancies. Duration up on a rail looking over the edge is only one part of an expectancy. So we believe there needs to be more conditions to evaluate other than just duration, and I'll show you what I mean by that later. So when we do exposures right now, We say, what are you most worried about happening? And what are the conditions under which you think that thing is most likely to happen? And then we design the exposure to replicate those conditions so that it provides the experience that maximally violates the expectancy. And this may involve sustained fear activation. Because if what the person is most worried about happening is passing out, if they remain fearful for a prolonged period of time, we really need to keep them fearful for a prolonged period of time in order to test out their expectancy. What is the risk if you focus on fear reduction as opposed to the conditions that maximally violate the expectancy? Is that your experience of exposure may not really work because you're not truly violating what the person needs to learn. They don't need to learn that fear goes away. They need to learn that they will not collapse if the fear remains. And so we try to veer away from fear reduction and focus on what does this individual need to learn. And we've also observed that focusing too much on fear reduction means that fear reduction becomes a safety signal. So I've certainly worked with patients in the past who went so strongly at doing their exposure over and over and over and over again and getting such relief from the fear's gone, the fear is gone, that the moment any episode of fear reasserted itself, full relapse occurred. So fear reduction in and of itself can serve as a safety signal which can inhibit or protect against extinction. Now, let's take this a little bit further. If you look at the extinction literature, typically there is an asymptote that happens, which means at this point, the person is no longer surprised anymore. They came in expecting something bad and they learn that nothing bad has happened, and so staying in the situation is not giving them any more chance to learn. There's no more surprise. So what Rescorla had suggested is that, let's introduce another conditional stimulus. Let's introduce another thing that predicts a negative outcome in the middle of doing an extinction training procedure. So you've got one CS that starts here, and then let's introduce another one. Because if you introduce another CS, you're going to raise the expectancy up again, expectancy that something bad could happen. Therefore, you have more chance to learn because you're going to again have a mismatch between what you're expecting to happen and what actually happens. So we've tested this in humans. This is the first study to actually do this in humans. I tried to represent this in, I don't know if it helps or hurts, but I tried to represent it in colors. This is all with geometric figures. So the main point is everybody goes through fear acquisition. That's supposed to represent a shock. So shocked, shocked, not shocked. Shocked, shocked, not shocked. Then everybody goes through extinction. So there's no shock. Then the single group goes through a little bit more extinction to the single CS. The compound group goes through extinction where you combine the two CSs together. You with me? So they're presented as a compound. And this is called deepened extinction. And now what we're going to do is we're going to test how do they react at a later point in time, 1 week later, when they're just exposed to this. And notice the single group gets more exposure to this alone than the compound group. You with me? So, 1 week later, we're measuring their reactivity to that single yellow circle. And you see the single group that actually got more exposure to this on its own is showing a much stronger fear response, this is skin conductance, than the compound group. And we then did something called reinstatement, which means we randomly shocked them without it being paired with anything. That's what that's technically reinstatement. It would be like you're walking along and suddenly somebody attacks you. It's an unexpected aversive event. And again, the single group, then we test their reaction to that yellow circle again. And again, the single group showing much more fear than the compound group. So having put two of those stimuli together seems to have protected the person from the resurgence of fear that it comes after a negative event. And this was true both in terms of skin conductance and in terms of how much they expected to be shocked again. The compound group became even less expectant of being shocked. So I'll put this together in a minute into exposure for phobics. But one more example here. How else can we raise the expectancy throughout extinction / exposure? Well, Rescorla said, why don't you throw in another unconditional stimulus as you're taking the person through extinction training? So traditionally, extinction training is there's no more aversive element, right? So it's just the tone without the shock. What if you throw in the shock every now and then? Occasionally. That should theoretically raise the expectancy again. So you've boosted up the expectancy. Oh no, I'm going to get shocked. And on the subsequent trials, you don't get shocked. So you've violated the expectancy again. You've created another mismatch. There are other theories as to why it would work. So we did that. This is the first study of this in humans. So look at this group up here. This blue group, they're going through extinction. They never get shocked, and they show that perfect, you know, reduction of responding, that skin conductance. They've asymptoted. They've gotten down to zero. This pink group, out of every 8 trials, 2 of them they get shocked. You can see they don't lose their fear response. They remain aroused throughout the extinction training because every now and then they're getting shocked. Similarly, with the expectancy of how much they think they're going to get shocked, you get the nice reduction here in the group that never get shocked, whereas those who occasionally do get shocked, they're remaining highly expectant. Bring them back 1 week later. So look at this. This is the group that never habituated. That's the end of extinction to 1 week later. So they've shown a reduction of fear. The group that asymptoted early and remained low show that typical return of fear. And similarly, in terms of the expectancy for something bad happening. So this, in my mind, is a perfect laboratory example of you do not need habituation throughout extinction or exposure in order to get a benefit. Because those people in the reinforced group, as you may recall, they did not habituate at all. And yet they benefited 1 week later. So when we conduct exposures, what we do is we not only design the exposures to violate expectancies from the outset, but we will throw in additional fear stimuli in the middle of the exposure. So a classic example, in fact we've done this for many years now, if somebody's driving, we might throw in interoceptive exposure halfway through the drive. Or if somebody's got contaminant fears, we'd start off with one contaminant, have it there, and then add a second contaminant into the same exposure trial. So we're doing multiple or compound stimuli. And we'll also do occasional negative outcomes during exposure. That's like that occasional reinforced extinction. So we build in deliberate social rejections throughout the exposure. We try to build in actual panic attacks as much as we can, sometimes having to rely on drugs like your yohimbine. Of course, some conditions you can't, it's not ethical to bring in the negative outcome. You can't have the person re-attacked. But there are some kinds of negative outcomes that are part of, you know, regular, normal human existence that it's fine to do. Now, this raises the whole question of the role of cognitive restructuring. So think about this. I'm saying we want to design exposures that violate expectancy, and the best way to do that is to create a mismatch between what the person expects can happen and what actually happens. So for us, cognitive restructuring is not a good thing to do before exposure. Because by cognitive restructuring, you're taking away the expectancy. So once they go into exposure, you're not getting that good mismatch between the expectancy and the outcome. So we have shifted our model to doing cognitive restructuring after completion of exposure. So in our treatments now, they come in for treatment day one. Day two, we go straight into exposure. That lasts for 7 sessions. And then after that, we throw in a module of cognitive restructuring. And I'm not even sure that that's necessary, but that's the way we're testing it out right now. So it does raise, it's an interesting clinical issue of how does cognitive restructuring fit with this model of violation by surprise? Okay, I'm going to shift now to a topic of variability. This actually started off with some work from cognitive scientists, who for years have been studying this phenomenon, that if you learn something, if you're trying to learn something new, if you learn it in a variable way, you will have greater chance retaining that information at a later point in time than if you learn it in a very blocked and consistent way. So, for example, if you want to learn a list of words, this would be a typical cognitive experiment, you're better off learning it by having to study it in different orders in the list. So don't always study the same order of words in the list. Mix it up. Or if you have to learn a motor task, you're better off learning the motor task from different locations or different angles than the same location and angle over and over and over again. And there are various theories for why that is. One of the most important ones, I think, is that when it's variable, you have to really work at it. It's not easy. It's actually hard. And according to the cognitive theorists, that makes the memory that you're learning more storable and retrievable. It's also possible that when you vary it up, so you're learning different ways of doing the same thing, or you're learning different ways of memorizing material, you're capturing a rule that says there's an invariance here, that there's some principle that applies across all of these different items that's the same. Traditionally, exposure-based therapies have been based on blocked and constant, not variable and random practice. Early on, we had done a study with spiders. One group had constant stimuli, meaning they had the same spider over and over and over and over again as they went through exposure therapy. The other group had varied stimuli, so they had multiple different spiders as they went through exposure therapy. And as you can see, when they were tested with a novel spider at the follow-up, the group that had the varied stimulus during exposure showed very little return of fear, whereas the group that had the constant, the same spider and over again, had more return of fear. We repeated this in acrophobia, fear of heights, where one group did blocked exposure, where we had them go to an outside stairwell that was unprotected, and they would start off at the first level, do the exposure there 4 times, then they'd go up to the second level of the stairwell and do the exposure there 4 times, all the way up to the final level. And they always did the exposure in the exact same way, whereas the random group, they might go straight to the 8th level, then down to the 2nd level, then maybe over to the 6th level. So it was variable in the order, and it was also variable in how they approached the railing. They might walk up and lean over, or put an arm down, or stretch backwards over the rail. They would vary it up. And again, it was the varied group, the blue bars, that showed less return of fear than the constant group. Most recently, contaminant anxiety. So these are individuals who are fearful of being contaminated. I don't know if you can see these images. That's a dirty old toothbrush. That's a dirty pair of socks. And that's a pee pad, so that dogs urinate on. And then in the blocked mast group, they would get one object per session, they would look at it, and then eventually spread it on their bodies. There were steps in between, but they did everything exactly the same way. In the random variable group, they got these in a random order each session, and they would maybe start by looking at it closely, or they maybe started by immediately spreading it on their body, so we mixed it up. They might do it for a short duration, they might do it for a long duration, although everybody was matched on the total minutes of exposure. And again, what you see is the slight benefit, in this case, for the varied group, seeing less return of fear in SUDS and also in heart rate. What does this variability do? As I said, it actually comes from learning and memory research. It doesn't come from extinction research, but when you think about it, having variable stimuli so that the person not always doing the same thing over and over and over again fits with an extinction learning model. Because by varying up the stimulus, you're probably, again, repeatedly raising the expectancy that something bad could happen, and you get another chance to violate that expectancy. You're probably also making sure the person is highly focused on the, they're paying attention. They're paying attention because things are changing all the time. And the risk when you're doing the same thing over and over and over and over again is not only do you get this habituation, which means you're not learning much anymore, you're not getting surprised anymore, it also means you're probably not attending to the CS, to the phobic stimulus as much. So the variability keeps the person attentive, focused on what they're actually doing. And we believe that attention is very important to learning. And as I said before, if the person knows that they can complete this exposure with 10 different types of social encounters or 10 different types of spiders, they're probably going to capture some principle of generalization, that it doesn't really matter what the spider is or what the social interaction is, the negative outcome doesn't seem to be occurring or is not as bad as they thought. I'll throw in another thought here about variability. And this is not extinction learning theory at all, but I do think that by having varied stimuli, you're enhancing the person's willingness to tolerate fear. You're having the person's willingness to engage regardless of how fearful they are. That study where we had people go through the acrophobia to different heights, so they'd start at the 10th floor, then they'd go down to the 5th floor, then back up to the 4th or the 2nd floor, whatever it was. Again, they did not habituate because they never knew what was going to happen. It was unexpected for them. They remained aroused throughout the whole experience and probably attentive throughout the whole experience, but they were the ones who benefited in the long run. So more evidence that you don't need to reduce fear, and that this may be partly about helping the person realize, doesn't matter how afraid I am, I can do this task. So tolerance of fear. How can you do this variability? You could, as I said, vary the stimuli. So instead of having the person repeat the same task with the same stimulus over and over and over again, mix it up. You could have them approach the stimuli in a different way. So sometimes when I'm doing work with people who have fears of heights, I'll have them walk slowly towards the edge. Then I'll have them run up towards the edge. Then I'll have them lean on the edge, so mixing it up as much as possible. We do variability in what item we're using from the hierarchy. Do we go to an item from the top, then go maybe down to the item from a lower level of the hierarchy? How long each exposure is, and how much time between each exposure, which I'll come back to later. This is just a quick a demonstration of the role of attention and salience. So I mentioned that I think what variability does is also keeping the person attentive. And the problem with fear habituation is that there's no new learning happening once the person's habituated, and they're probably not attending to the phobic stimulus as well as they should be. What we had done in this study is we used attentional bias modification training. You're all familiar with this? Attentional bias modification training, which is training people to attend to a certain stimulus. Who's familiar with this? A few? Okay, very briefly then, what you do is you present a stimulus, and then you present what are called probes, like these dots. And you have to identify whether the probes are occurring, how quickly the probes are occurring. When you're trying to train someone to attend to a particular stimulus, you make sure the probes are always in the place where that stimulus previously was. So you present the stimulus goes off, there's just a fixation cross, and then the probes appear. So if I want to train people to attend to a blue triangle, I'm going to make sure that these probes very frequently occur in the area that the blue triangle just occupied. That's basically what attentional bias modification training is. And if I want people to attend to something else, then I'll make sure the probes almost always occur in the space previously occupied by that stimulus. When we do that, and here we're doing it in a laboratory study of fear conditioning, so we take people through acquisition, and then we extinguish them, and then we have them, we take them through acquisition, then we train them to either attend to this or this. This one was the cue associated with shock. This was the cue never associated with shock. And then we had a control condition as well. And simply to show you, these are preliminary data, that when we train people to attend to the thing that predicted shock originally, that's the conditional stimulus that had been associated with shock, and then we test them later on, this is a week later, those people show less return of fear as measured by an expectancy rating than those people who are trained to attend to the other stimulus or not trained to attend to either. So focusing the attention on the object of fear, we think, is quite important. And we got the same effect, and I won't belittle this. I won't go over this now because we don't have time, but we got the same effect in skin conductance. Okay. So, we've discussed violation of expectancy. We've discussed variability of stimulus. I want to spend a little bit of time on context renewal. So, as I said, extinction learning is highly context-specific. So, if I take somebody through exposure therapy, what they learn in exposure is likely to be very tied to where we do it, who we do it with, under what precise conditions we do the exposure. So when you test people in a context that is different than the context in which they did exposure therapy, you often see a return of fear. And that's shown here. So these people are tested in the same context as the context in which they did exposure therapy. You don't see any return of fear. These people were tested in a different context. This was public speaking fear. So you see that resurgence of fear in their level of self-reported fear and also in their heart rate. So the question is, how do you offset this context renewal? And one way to do it is to do multiple contexts in your exposure therapy. So throw in as many different contexts as you can, which might mean the kind of situation. Is the person practicing their exposure alone or with others? Or at home, or in familiar or unfamiliar places, try to mix it up as much as you can. That seems to help. You might need to consider internal context. So if the person goes through exposure therapy while they're always on a drug, that means that learning, theoretically, is going to be tied to being on the drug. So it would be good to have them practice without the drug in the system. And if you can, if you know what was the initial context in which they acquired their fear, let's say it was a specific location, it's great to go back to that initial context because that's particularly powerful. That context will carry a lot of excitatory potential. So it's good to go back and do the exposure therapy there. Another way is to do a retrieval cue. So a retrieval cue is a neutral object that is present with the person as they go through exposure therapy, and then it becomes the bridge. It becomes the way of retrieving the memory of what happened during exposure therapy, so that when they're tested at a later point in time, if that retrieval cue is there, it will help recall the memory of the exposure. So we had done a study using these as retrieval cues for public speaking anxiety. Funny little pens that the person had to use with trolls' heads on them and a neon board, as simple as that. And then we compared four groups. This group didn't have a retrieval cue either during exposure or when they were tested later. This group didn't have the retrieval cue during exposure, but it was present later. That shouldn't make any difference. This group had the retrieval cue during exposure, but not when they were tested later. That shouldn't make a difference. And this group had the retrieval cue present during exposure and when they were tested later, and they showed the least return of fear. So this represents the percentage of the sample that showed a renewal of fear. The effect was there, it was mild, because it only occurred in this kind of chi-square analysis of presence or absence of return of fear. It wasn't observable in dimensional measures. However, we did do another kind of retrieval cue, which is so easy to implement. And so all we did is when we brought people back, so they went through exposure therapy, this was the spiders, we brought them back for a follow-up test, and one group we said, remember what you learned, what happened and what you learned last time and where that all took place. The other group, we said, just remember all the things that you do to get ready before going to school or work. So this is the retrieval cue. It was just a mental reinstatement. And I was surprised by this, but what happened is, so here, everybody goes through exposure, and everybody here is tested in a different context, a physical context, that differs from the one in which they did exposure therapy. So everybody's showing some return of fear. But the group that got this instruction had less, that's statistically different, less return of fear. So such a simple thing to do when working with patients, just to have them remind themselves of what they learned and where they were last time. Our latest development in this area of context specificity has to do with a pharmacological agent called scopolamine. So context specificity of extinction is something that is largely dependent on the hippocampus, because the hippocampus encodes spatial temporal features of context, well established. And my colleague, Mike Fanzelow, who's my animal researcher who I rely upon, has found that if you down-regulate the hippocampus during extinction, then the learning is no longer context-specific, it generalizes. How do they do that? Well, first of all, they lesion the hippocampus. I don't think we can do that. But they've also looked at a pharmacological agent called scopolamine. My daughter uses scopolamine for motion sickness. Interestingly, the pharmacological effect of scopolamine is that it kind of temporarily disables the hippocampus. And what they found is that here is the group that just had the saline, not scopolamine, like this is the placebo. When they were tested in a different context, you get that usual return of fear. But when they had scopolamine, it blocked the return of fear. There's no return of fear here. So we have a study going on right now where we're using scopolamine. This is for individuals with social anxiety disorder, and they are randomized to either placebo, 0.2, 0.4, or 0.6 milligrams of scopolamine injected in the nose through a spray, which helps to cross the blood-brain barrier. And then they go through exposure therapy in a virtual reality context. Virtual reality makes it easier to manipulate context. They do 7 sessions over the course of 4 weeks, and they do 7 speeches per session. And then day 32, we bring them back, and we test them in the same context as the extinction exposure context, and a different context. So in 2 years, you'll have to have me come back to tell you the results. But I wanted to show you where we're heading. Ah, now, so extinction, context tied, context specific, that's a problem. We want the learning to generalize, right? You want when people to leave exposure therapy, what they've learned to spread across all different kind of contexts. Go the other way. When somebody first acquires fear, we want that learning to become as context specific as possible, right? Because you don't want it to generalize. You'd rather have it be really tightly tied to a context. So, what's interesting is that when people go through intense fear or trauma, hippocampal functioning is usually shut off a little bit. What does that mean? That impairs contextual memory, which means you get this broad generalization of fear. So we need to find a way to try to fix this. And surprisingly, glucose actually helps hippocampal functioning. And so my other colleague from the rat world, Tom Miner, has now demonstrated that if he gives glucose immediately after being traumatized, which for rats means a series of uncontrollable shocks, that glucose makes the learning more context specific and you get less fear generalization. So it's a simple procedure. We tested this in humans. We have a context here. We also have a cue. So every time the CS comes on, they get shocked. CS comes on, they get shocked. In this case, this is called cued conditioning because the cue is the best predictor of shock. The background context doesn't matter that much, all right? Then we have something called context conditioning. So they see this background context, they get an unpredictable shock, they get a cue that's unrelated to the shock. They might get another cue unrelated to the shock. They get another unpredictable shock. So in this situation, the context, the background context, becomes the predictor of shock. It's not the cue. And that's how you do context conditioning. So we then administered either glucose or placebo to these people as they went through these kind of trials. This here is the acquisition of fear to the context in which there were unpredictable shocks. And you can see the glucose actually increased fear of that context, but it had no effect on the context in which the cue was reliably paired with shock. You with me? So it did not affect cue conditioning, it affected context conditioning, whereas the placebo group didn't have any reliable effects. So a surprising finding, I think, because what it means technically is if you know somebody is at risk for being traumatized, let's say first responders, or if you know somebody's just being traumatized, glucose might actually be helpful. And that's what's currently being tested out in emergency rooms in University of Southern California right now. Interesting development. Consolidation scheduling, quickly, we have found that if you have progressively increasing intervals of time from one session to the next session to the next session, you get a benefit. This comes from cognitive science on spacing of learning, increases the storage and retrieval of newly learned information. So booster sessions after the end of exposure therapy that are progressively further and further apart should theoretically be a good thing. And now I want to focus on the last two issues. Positive valence. This is interesting. This is a newer area of research for us. So when we take people through exposure therapy, have you noticed that, yes, as we said, generally, people do become less fearful. Not that that's a critical measure of outcome, but generally people do become less fearful, but they don't usually like the stimulus. So they might become less fearful of driving, but they don't usually like driving. They might become less fearful of dogs, but they might not usually like dogs. And that dislike of the phobic stimulus is actually a predictor of the vulnerability to a return of fear at a later point in time. So the more you dislike it, the greater the chances that when an unexpected negative event happens, you're going to reinstate the original fear. So how can we offset that? How can we try to prevent that return of fear? So what we have been doing is trying to induce positive affect to the conditional stimulus. So this is not about fear, this is about inducing positive valence. So we take people through acquisition, so they learn to be fearful of a conditional stimulus, and then we randomly assign them to these two conditions. And this comes from Emily Holmes's work at Cambridge. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but she's developed this really neat set of programs. So how do you train people to have positive affect? And so she uses something called positive imagery training, which is a set of scenarios like it's your birthday and your partner reaches out to you with a present and you open it and you feel incredibly happy. So it always ends with a positive word. Or your boss walks by and pats you on the back and says, "You've done a great job." Things like that. And what they have to do is imagine the scenario. So for Emily Holmes, imagery is really critical. And rate the vividness of the image. So we had people either do that, or they did positive verbal training, which is the same scenarios, but there's no imagery. They're just told to concentrate on the words and rate the difficulty of the words. So this is quite a stringent comparison, actually, because they're both positive scenarios. One's imagery and one's verbal. So we did that. And we were hoping that by doing that, we would actually increase positive affect in this group. And we did. It worked. It actually increases positive affect much more, significantly more than doing this. We also hoped that it would increase how positively the person rated the CS plus, and it did. So those in this group ended up saying, "I like the CS plus more than people in this group." And then we took them through reinstatement. So again, we exposed them to unpredictable shocks and tested what the effect was of that. And so this is from the end of extinction, and this is after the shock. And you see those who went through positive imagery training actually showed a reduction in their defensive motivational state measured by startle, and those who went through the verbal training showed an increase in their startle after being reinstated, and the same effect with self-reported fear. We then tested this out in a spider phobic sample. So now we have everybody go through exposure to a live spider, Pepe, and then we randomly assign them to a positive valence training video versus a neutral valence training video. So what did we use for the positive valence training video? We used Charlotte's Web. Because in Charlotte's Web, I don't know if you know that story, the spider is described as this gentle, kind being that helps the world in so many ways and has a hard life in spinning webs and has so many children to take care of and is very wise. It's a very wise spider. And then the neutral valence training, where I think was about a National Geographic video. And then we reinstated. So how do you reinstate in spider fears? So we had this horrific image, actually, of a tarantula eating a live mouse. My students have great times finding this stuff. But so this was supposed to, you know, bring back that fear. It's actually not technically reinstated, it's just exposure to something horrible. And then we tested how did the two groups perform. And again, so the blue line here are the National Geographic people. And this is the Charlotte's Web group. So after they go through exposure and after the reinstatement, we're measuring how close were they able to get to the spider in a behavioral avoidance test. They got closer. So something here about positive valence as a tool for enhancing the consolidation of extinction learning. Now, I'm going to finish up on this thing of inhibitory regulation of affect. Ooh, I'm running over time, sorry. This is a totally different area. So I've said, you know, extinction primarily we think involves the medial prefrontal cortex, which inhibits the amygdala. Affect labeling. What is affect labeling? Affect labeling is the use of words in response to emotional states. So it comes from the work of my colleague Matt Liebman, who has this particular theory called disruption theory, which is when you use language in response to emotional stimuli, you activate an area of the brain called the right ventral lateral prefrontal cortex, which via the medial prefrontal cortex down-regulates the amygdala. And then you have better management of negative affect. Here's an example of affect labeling. There's a face, and you have to choose the word that matches the face. That's technically what affect labeling is. You're just selecting the best word to match the emotional stimuli. And it's usually compared to all these other comparison conditions. And when you do that affect labeling, you typically see this reduction. So this is the parameter estimate for the amygdala. You see much less amygdala activation than you do in all these other conditions. And you see a very nice correlation, meaning that the greater the right ventral lateral prefrontal cortex that's activated, the less amygdala that's activated. So they work as, it's an inhibitory pathway from the right ventral lateral to the amygdala. In our hands, when we did our study with anxious individuals, so these are individuals with pretty severe social anxiety with other comorbid anxiety disorders, and social anxiety disorder with depression, and this is the healthy control group. They're going through standard affect labeling in the scanner, and you can see, yes, affect labeling leads to less amygdala reactivity than gender label. That's the typical control condition that you compare to. What's interesting here is that the socially anxious group didn't show that. And in fact, as they became more anxious and more depressed, you saw an increase in amygdala activation. They weren't getting that inhibitory regulation going on. Another piece of evidence that anxiety, in this case, anxiety and depression, is somehow the core mechanism is an inhibitory failure. You're not getting that what you should expect to see regulatory pathway being activated. So it raises the question, okay, can we train people in affect labeling? Is that going to be an effective technique? And so we did a number of studies starting off with healthy controls where we would show them unpleasant images like a gun or a dog that's angry or a bloody face. They'd look at the image, and then we'd throw in the affect label. Here we have an irrelevant label. So that's an angry dog, word bomb. Here we have a relevant label, blood, blood. And we did hundreds of trials of this kind of labeling. And then 1 week later, we just measured how are they responding to these images. And what we found is that those who used the irrelevant label had a significantly greater reduction from day one to day eight in their skin conductance and heart rate response than those who did exposure alone without the label. Notice it was the irrelevant label where that was most effective. So the word bomb associated with the dog. Then we took spider-phobic individuals and we did exposure alone, so just images of spiders. Then we did the negative label group, and we chose the irrelevant label here because of the previous study, and then neutral. Did hundreds of trials, brought them back a week later, and again, you see a significantly greater attenuation of the skin conductance and heart rate response when they used the negative irrelevant label compared to exposure alone. We then did a study where we looked at the relationship between how much right ventral lateral prefrontal cortex activation occurred in the scanner and whether it predicted subsequent attenuation of the skin conductance response 1 week later, and it did. But now we're back to the relevant label. So it's confusing and unclear, should it be relevant or irrelevant from these studies. But we proceeded nonetheless with spidophobic individuals. And we had four groups. So the labeling was, sitting in front of the ugly spider makes me feel very nervous. That would be an example of affect labeling. So we're using relevant, right? Reappraisal. Sitting in front of the little spider is not dangerous for me. Trying to reappraise it is not as bad. Distraction. There's a table in front of the couch in my den. Exposure alone. Oh, it's Pepe again. They came back 1 week later. We're looking at skin conductance change from the end of exposure to 1 week later. The affect labeling group significantly different than every other group. So just labeling that emotional response led them to be much less aroused when they re-encountered the spider, and they approached the spider, they got closer to it in comparison to the distraction group. And furthermore, the more words they used, so we used a Pennebaker analysis of all the words they used, the more words they used which represented, I'm nervous, I'm afraid, I'm scared, I'm panicky, the better the outcome. We've replicated this now in public speaking anxiety. So before they give each speech, they say, I feel, and they choose one of these words, I feel anxious, angry, sad. And we give them sort of variations on the words to choose. That the audience will laugh at me, judge me negatively, think I'm weird. So we're just stating the emotional response to the stimulus. And again, this is just coming out now, this is physiological data from baseline to post-exposure to retest 1 week later. The group that had the affect labeling are showing a reduction over time in how physiologically they react to public speaking compared to the control group. And this is the same thing in terms of skin conductance compared to the control group, both significant effects. So we're now testing this out with post-traumatic stress disorder. And I'm particularly interested in this study because, as you may know, the gold standard exposure model for post-traumatic stress disorder is 45 minutes of prolonged imaginal exposure to the memory of the trauma over 12 sessions, or maybe 8 sessions. That's really hard to do. And there's a huge dropout, at least in the VA in the States where it's being rolled out, where people are dropping out of this treatment. What we are proposing is something very different, and it would be this, that we use a scripture imagery procedure. We have them create a trauma script from their own trauma. They listen to it for 30 seconds. They imagine the scene for 60 seconds. And then they affect label, our comparison and shape match. So right now I feel, and they select one of these words about my trauma. And then right now I feel, and let's say they chose angry about my, and they would select one of these words. They do that for 30 seconds, then there's a 2 minute break, and then they do that whole thing 10 times. And our pilot data are showing that this is actually very effective. And it would be wonderful if we can make this into an automated program so that it doesn't even require a therapist to guide the person through it. So it's a very different model that we're testing here. What does affect labeling do in terms of extinction? I don't know. It could augment extinction, because by affect labeling, you're definitely having the person enhance their attention to the object of their fear. It could enhance the disconfirmation of expectancy, because you're having them verbalize how bad it is for them or what they're feeling in a negative way. Or it could be that it's a totally separate process that just works alongside extinction mechanisms, that it's a separate inhibitory regulatory pathway that maybe complements extinction learning. I think it also maps onto tolerance of fear, because what we encourage our patients to do is to label their emotions as they go through exposure. We're not doing restructuring of any kind. It's just label the emotion with the knowledge I'm going forward anyway. So I'm anxious and I'm doing it. I'm terrified and I'm going to do this exposure practice. So if we put it all together, so this is just as an example of how we would set up an exposure therapy. So we would start off with a general optimal exposure. What is it that you need to address going to parties? What are you most worried about is going to happen? I will be rejected. How can I best test this out? So this is, what do I need to do to maximally violate that expectancy? All right, so I need to go to a party and start several conversations with several people. I need to do it for at least an hour. I need to do it at a party where I don't know many people, and I need to discuss something that I don't know much about and talk to more than one person. If I did all of that and I wasn't rejected, then I would be really surprised. So that would be our conditions of maximal violation. I'd also need to get rid of safety behaviors, which we haven't talked about today so much. And if I put it all together, this is my optimal exposure. So we do that first. Then we say, all right, what's your first exposure? Because sometimes people can't do the optimal one straight away. So the first exposure is, I'm going to, what am I testing out? And we're trying to make this as concrete as possible. I'm testing out whether someone will walk away and stop talking to me if I make eye contact while discussing politics, okay? And how am I testing it out? I'm going to make eye contact with people while discussing politics at a party. And then these are our optional strategies, and they could do all of them, some of them, but at least one of them. So what am I throwing out? This is safety behaviors. I'm going to throw out, you know, avoiding eye contact. How am I going to stay with it? This is, how do I keep my attention focused? I'm going to just focus on the conversation. How will I combine it? Here we said not applicable, but you could say, well, I'm going to combine it with eating spicy food so that I'm sweating a lot as I'm doing it. How will I face it? So this is that occasional reinforced extinction. Well, I'm going to talk to the person who I know is extremely critical of my beliefs in order to get them to criticize me. How will I talk it out? I'm going to label my emotions. So that's affect labeling. So putting it together, this is my first exposure. The exposure is not based on how much fear I am experiencing, unless what they need to test out has to do with being afraid. Does that make sense? So it's based on whatever it is they need to learn. And the exposure ending isn't based on fear level. It's just based on what are the conditions that I need to go through. At the just before they do the exposure practice, we say how like, you know, we get them to rate how likely it is they think that what they're most worried about will actually occur. We may get them to rate how bad would it be if it actually did happen, and what their current distress level is. At the end of exposure, they've now completed the exposure, distress level. Did what I was most worried about occur, yes or no? How do I know? So here we want to consolidate. We want them to really think through, how do you know it didn't happen? Sarah seemed interested, no one ended the conversation, Jewel came back. If the event that they worried about did happen, was it as bad as they expected? That's not applicable here. Now, a little bit more consolidation. What did I expect to happen as a result of doing this exposure? What happened, and did that surprise me? So we're trying to force people to recognize the violation effect. So I thought, well, you can read that. And again, what did I learn? And imagine I was asked to do another exposure practice just like this one. How likely is it that what I'm most worried about will occur next time, and how bad will it be? So we're trying to get them to really think through what they've learned from the exposure. We call that the consolidation phase. So that's not cognitive restructuring, that's consolidation of learning. Okay, I'm sorry that I've gone over time. So, conclusion, the long-term success of exposure therapy depends on the strength and retrievability of the inhibitory associations and the underlying neuroregulation. Fear reduction within a given exposure trial is an index of performance, but it's not an index of learning. And these are some of the things that we've talked about as ways of trying to optimize the learning during exposure therapy. This is the tool package that I was mentioning early on. And the reason why I've highlighted this particular one here is because you will probably notice that particular one does overlap a lot with behavioral experimentation in a cognitive model approach. But as you can see, we don't rely on that alone, that we have all these other factors that we're working on. Thank you very much.